Just a couple more questions for you. Some from Pete Beaumont, and I'm sorry if I pronounced your name wrong. Yeah, a non-internet related question. This one always gets me laughing. Pete, do you ever sleep?
Don't ask my wife that question. No.
Do you? I mean, I can understand. You're a CEO of one of the largest and fastest growing internet companies in Canada.
Sure.
You know, sleeping is a hard thing when you're an entrepreneur, and especially when everything has been very successful with the hard work of the people that are here and yourself. And, you know, successful people don't sleep a lot.
Yeah, I think you keyed in on something there. You know, the people that are here have really helped us grow. So, you know, we certainly have had some success in the last successive growth. We've done well in the last couple of years in terms of growth. And a lot of that, you know, certainly when you grow from a company that's, you know, 10 or 20 people to a company that's approaching 150, there's certainly a lot of challenges and a lot of sleepless nights as you go through that process. But we've been fortunate that the people that we've brought in to really help us through that growth, we have an amazing team that's really helped us manage to maintain the same culture. We've had people telling us for the last 10 years, you know, don't grow too big, and you know, we certainly appreciate and understand that, because to us, you know, that culture is paramount in everything we do. You know, it's not just the words that are printed on many walls as you come through the organization, but you know, when you live that type of culture, I think it makes it a lot easier. And having a good team here has really helped me get some of that sleep. That, you know, I'm sleeping a little better the last, you know, let's say the last year for sure.
And like I said before, it's not just you that is successful at this, it's everybody in their job here that is successful at what they're doing to where we've gotten as a company. So it's,
yeah, I'm pretty proud of our team.
Yeah,
you should get some sleep.
Yeah.
We got two more questions. Cam N writes in this question: have you ever considered a gigabyte point-to-point wireless network on an unlicensed spectrum as an alternative to buying what she calls slow access to the big three networks? And I loved being a customer for a long time, and she would love to be one again. And so I'm assuming she's not in our area.
Well, sorry that you're not with us anymore, but thanks for the question, and hopefully we'll get you back with us. Good question. Okay, so the question said gigabit point-to-point.
Gigabit point-to-point wireless on an unlicensed.
Okay, so few things in that. So first of all, I think the question might refer to gigabit multipoint. So in a, just kind of talk about that a little bit. A point-to-point is generally two antennas that are dedicated for one person. So in a point-to-point network, I would have an antenna and you would have an antenna, and that antenna would be for just our communication. That's the point-to-point. So in a consumer-based configuration architecture, generally it would be a multipoint, so one antenna that would broadcast to many many people. So if it was so obviously a gigabit point-to-point wouldn't work, because if we had 10,000 customers on it, we would have to have 10,000 antennas all pointing, and that would be pretty crammed up on the top of a building. But for a multipoint, some of the challenges, especially in unlicensed, is that you really don't control the environment. And one of the challenges with wireless is what's called a hidden node problem. So with traditional wireless technologies like an unlicensed spectrum, is that the tower, you know, is kind of listening to everybody that's communicating with it. It's kind of similar to an issue that if you went into a room and you know, a person was standing in the middle of the room and they were talking to one person, they could have a conversation with that one person. But if 100 people were in that room all talking at the same time, that person wouldn't be able to understand any of them. All the voices would overlap and collide, and that's kind of what happens in spectrum. So with in a human kind of environment, there's a social protocol. You know, if somebody else is talking, you're not talking, and that's how you can have 100 people in a room and still be able to communicate, because, you know, there's only one conversation going on at the same time. In a in an unlicensed spectrum, like a gigabit network, what ends up happening is each one of those people can't see that they're in the room. So say, you know, take example that one person, you know, is now a tower and it's sitting in the middle of a city, and you've got consumers that are spread out all across the city. they can't hear each other talking to that person in the middle. And so the person in the middle is getting all of these overlapping signals. So there's a lot of protocols that kind of try to deal with that, like time division multiplexing. But what it is not really scalable, again, in an unlicensed spectrum, because other people would, you know, other providers would be using the same thing. We used to do some rural wireless, and you would have an issue with putting more than, say, 20 or 30 people on a tower. So you'd have all these kind of micro pops. And that was fine for rural areas that were kind of sparse. And, 30 people, you know, we'd talk to a tower and everything would be fine. But to try to put that into a major city for an ISP to put up a tower, or, you know, even 10 towers in a city, and try to scale that to more than a couple hundred customers, unfortunately, just wouldn't work.
Yeah, too much interference. There could be, I use my analogy of the baby monitor, right? You put it in, it doesn't know if it should be the first thing that is the priority in the house, or if it's the streaming of, you know, a YouTube channel or something else that's using the Wi-Fi, and then you might end up getting someone else's audio from a baby cam, you know.
Exactly.
There's a lot of things that can
happen. It's those neighbors that are on the same frequency sort of thing.
Exactly.
They're kind of all overlapping that same frequency.
And this really ties into the whole conversation of people talking about LTE versus, you know, having an LTE connection in their home for internet versus having the traditional cable or DSL or fiber connection into their home.
Yeah, and LTE certainly has more capability than, you know, previous Edge or X, or, you know, even 3G networks. There's more capacity, but even, you know, if you look at spectrum, it's frequency basically that, you know, is zipping through the air. There's only so much capacity of that spectrum. There's only so much radio waves that are dedicated for, you know, wireless and internet communication, that it just isn't a replacement for something like fiber, where fiber, you know, in a single strand has more capacity in that single strand than all of the entire spectrum across, like, all bands, not even just internet bands. But so there's, you know, technology continues to improve and speeds continue to get bigger, but they still suffer from the same problem that one LTE node might, say, for example, have, you know, a certain number of gigabits of capacity, but that capacity is shared again with a relatively large area, and a lot of time is spent with the devices being able to negotiate when they can communicate back to the tower.
So that's fascinating.
It's great for mobile video and stuff like that, but it's still not quite a replacement for.
We should do a show strictly
just on
this
topic. I love this kind of
very interesting topic. Yeah. Well, we're going to do something that's called In the News, and right now in the local paper here in London, in the Free Press, there was a great article, and it talked a little bit about mainstream London and the LEDC program. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of people have been online asking questions about this, because I think they just don't understand a little bit about the program, and there could be some confusion. So I think this is a good opportunity to talk about the program,
sure,
what it was there for, and what ended up happening.
Okay. Cool. So I think it was a couple years ago now, maybe two, three years ago. They were really trying to look at how to make the downtown core more tech friendly.
In London.
In London, yes. And so LEDC is the Economic Development Corporation of London, and so they worked together with Downtown London and the city to try to put together a program that would kind of incent or be able to be available for companies that were looking to be able to add more tech, more, you know, more capability internet to their business. And because a lot of the cost of fiber is very capital expensive.
Installation and stuff.
Exactly.
Like that.
So they leveraged, if I recall, they leveraged something that was kind of like the Community Improvement Plan program, which was kind of an established program already, generally for improving buildings, you know, often used for facelifts of buildings or other infrastructure that might be upgraded in that building, and use the same kind of program for fiber. So the program was that you would pay for the installation up front, and then we'd get 50% back. So the program had great intentions for sure, and but it wasn't utilized a lot, because it was still quite a economic barrier for business to get into. Even if you're getting 50% back of a $20,000 installation, it's still $10,000 that you need to come up with. So I think that was one of the reasons that wasn't really utilized. We kind of took a different approach in London, that we know that fiber is a long-term part of our strategy, and we've just decided that we're going to be just rolling fiber out. So we've already connected hundreds of buildings, from small homes to multiple dwelling units, small condos, etc., and businesses throughout the core, and continue to expand it. So yeah, there was an article the other day, I guess, that said they were able to shut the program down and take, I forget, $200,000 or something that had been earmarked for it, and put it back into other infrastructure programs in the city. So
basically,
cool.
in just to summarize that, there was a program available for businesses to take advantage of some sort of subsidy or incentive for them to get fiber or whatever it would be installed at their locations. They would get a certain percent back, and so would the company obviously installing it.
Nope.
Or it would be used towards that.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, it went right back to the building owner.
But Start took a position of, we're not going to wait, we're just going to move ahead. It's the right thing to do. We want to make sure that we can get as much fiber in the ground as we can.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's good for us. I mean, we get in front of the customers and are able to provide them something that they couldn't get before. And we take a little bit longer run on how long we expect that return on investment to be. Mm-hmm. And so we kind of do a bit of a build it and they will come. And it's been successful for us. We've had a really good uptake on it.
So the best thing about it is the remainder of the funds that were available got reallocated back to the city and to other programs now.
Yeah, the city's undergoing a smart city initiative in terms of a lot of, how can they bring more tech and more innovation to the city. And so the money, I think, is going to go into a lot of those types of programs.
Great. Very proud of that. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to have more questions answered and you want to ask them, please go on Facebook. Go and you can ask us any type of questions. It's the opportunity to talk one-on-one with the CEO of Start.ca, Mr. Peter Rocca. Maybe you got some marketing questions. You talk to me. We don't know. It's up to you. Any questions you have, we're gonna move the veil on anything, and you can get to kind of go behind the scenes of how an internet service provider really works. And we want to be as transparent with all of our followers and all of our customers. And if you're not our customer, it's the exact same thing. We want to be transparent with you for what we do and how this industry works. You can email us at starttalk@start.ca, or once again, follow us on social media, and you'll find there. And you can find all the questions and answers you want for the next episode of Start Talk. My name is Aaron Thomas, Marketing Director of Start.ca. And this is Peter Rocca, CEO of Start.ca, and thank you very much for today's edition.
Thanks, and we'll get to that TV stuff on the next show.